Hi everyone. In today's video, we're going to talk about sealed classes within Java. Sealed classes were a preview feature added in JDK 15, they were refined again in JDK 16, and then they were added officially to the language in JDK 17. So I'm going to pull up IntelliJ, and if you want to follow along while we're looking at code, make sure that your JDK is 15 or later, ideally 17 or later. Today's project we'll call sealed classes. So the gist of this feature is that when language designers added this concept of inheritance into object-oriented programming, what it turns into is you kind of have to do one or the other. You either have to assume inheritance or you have to prevent inheritance in your code. And what happens is if you assume inheritance, oftentimes that can actually go too far, and a user of your code can try to inherit from your classes or your interfaces when they weren't intended to be in a particular way. So sealed classes are a way of managing that, and I'll talk about how that's done here in a second. So to start, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new class. I'm going to call it a shape, and it's actually going to be an interface. And if you have any questions on using interfaces, abstract classes, inheritance, anything like that, go ahead and check out one of my previous videos on those topics. Because to understand sealed classes, you need to understand kind of those original basics to start. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and make an interface, and it's going to be called shape. And now I want the shape interface to have one method. It's going to say numSides. It's going to return an integer. So now I'm going to go ahead and add some implementations for my shape. So I'm going to make a class called circle, which is going to implement shape. And then likewise, I'm going to make a class called rectangle that implements shape. And if I hover over this, what it's saying is I need to implement the methods within the shape interface. In this case, I'm going to say that circle has 0 sides, and I'm going to say that a rectangle has 4 sides. But one major issue with this is there's nothing preventing me from doing something like this. And then I'm an implementer. I don't really know what numSides for blue is. I'm just going to go ahead and put -1 right here. There's nothing saying that this code wouldn't work. I don't know about you, but I don't think that blue is a shape. I think that a shape could be blue. So this is a case where you want to use composition rather than inheritance. But pre-JDK 15, there was no way to actually enforce this. This was more of like a human code review kind of thing. So now with JDK 15, though, we can enforce this at compile time. Yes. So let me demonstrate how you do that. What you do is with an interface, a class, or an abstract class, you can add the sealed keyword. And the sealed keyword, in addition to a few other ones we'll talk about today, are what are called contextual keywords, meaning that they don't affect your code elsewhere. If you use a variable named sealed or something like that, you can still do that. And the whole intent of a contextual keyword is to make the code backward compatible so you don't have to update your legacy code when you move to new JDKs. Instead, the idea is that the keyword means certain things depending on the context it's written in. So if I use the keyword sealed right here, now it means something, versus if I just had it as a variable name within a method of my class, it wouldn't mean a sealed interface or anything like that. Okay, so now all of my classes that implement just turned red. So that's because I need to do the second part of using the sealed keyword is I need to add the permits keyword. Basically what I'm about to do here is when I'm referring to a sealed class, abstract class, or interface, that means that I am restricting the direct children in an inheritance hierarchy of it. So think about that for a second. So now instead of having my implementer be able to extend my interface, let's say, however they want to, now they're restricted in which particular implementations can extend it. So I have to indicate which ones those are, and it's the permits keyword that allows for that. So in this case, I want to permit circle and rectangle. But I still have some errors here, and the reason for that is because my direct implementers of a sealed class or interface, they have to indicate one of three states. They either have to be final, meaning that they're closed for modification. They have to be sealed as well, meaning that they also have a restricted set of descendants. or they can be non-sealed. And that means that their inheritance hierarchy can be opened up. So in the case of circle, I'm going to go ahead and say that a circle is final. In the case of a rectangle, I know that I would want a square underneath rectangle. So I'm going to go ahead and just say non-sealed. But I could have also said sealed here and then included square, for example. But in the case of blue, I don't have anything to go off here, so I'm actually just going to delete this because I have no way of implementing nor extending the shape interface if it's not in this list. So, what are the benefits here? Number one, I can determine who is going to be extending my API. And what that means is that I can have control over those classes more so than pre-JDK 15. So for example, let's say that I am delivering some code to another user, or let's say that I'm in class and I'm writing some code and I'm giving it to my classmates, or I'm handing it over to another team. I now have a lot more control over how the code works because I can restrict the inheritance to only those classes that I know about and are okay to be inherited from. You might also be thinking, how's this different from enums? Because enums are a direct set of known instantiations of a particular contract. And the main difference you get over sealed classes versus enums is that with an enum, every single instantiation is final at the end and you can't extend it. Whereas with something like a non-sealed class that implements a sealed interface, you can then further extend it. So this doesn't obsolete enums by any stretch of the imagination, but this is another thing that we should add into our tool belts to make good object-oriented design. Because while we do want to allow extension of our code, if we allow too much extension and reuse, then it can lead to bugs and problems that we wouldn't have foreseen. Or we could have a bad actor trying to get into our code in a way that was never intended. Just to demonstrate that this applies to more than just interfaces, I'm going to rewrite the code a little bit to convert this into an abstract class. And here with just a few small changes, we converted our interface into an abstract class. And we can see that the sealed, non-sealed, permits, all those sorts of semantics stay the same. One thing that I haven't mentioned is that when sealed was proposed, there were two additional things that the language designers wanted to make sure were not a goal of the sealed functionality. The first one is that they didn't want to change the meaning of the final keyword with classes. I've talked about that a little bit here. A final class still means that it cannot be extended, and that functionality hasn't changed at all with this. The second thing is that they didn't want to introduce the concept of friend classes. That's something, if you have a C++ background, that basically allows two classes to share private data members and functions. And the language designers chose not to include anything like that with this sealed functionality. Really, all that sealed is doing is it's preventing what would be regular inheritance relationships among class hierarchies. It doesn't add additional functionality beyond that, but to be honest, I don't think it really needs to, because the main intent of sealed is to seal inheritance hierarchies into the known set that we care about. Another benefit of sealed is that now that I have the known list of children that I can instantiate at runtime, that means I can do a lot of compile time checks. So in a previous video, we talked about switch expressions and pattern matching. We can do that with sealed classes as well. So let me go ahead and demonstrate that. So let's say I want to make a shape. And I'm going to make a circle in this case. Let's say that I want to make a switch expression that prints out some sort of string based on the type that my shape is. All right, so one thing important you'll notice within my switch expression is that it's not complaining about needing a default. That's really important because normally if I were to do something like this with a non-sealed abstract class or interface, it would tell me that I needed a default clause. But in this case, I don't, because the compiler at compile time knows exactly the list of descendants of this interface or class that I could possibly have. That's pretty cool, right? And as expected, we get the printout of this is a circle. If I were to change this to a rectangle, I would get this is a rectangle. Now, just to demonstrate how this is different, if I were to get rid of the sealed relationship, I can leave this as a final class, but I can't mark this as non-sealed anymore. Now if we hover over here, it says switch expression does not cover all possible input values. Again, because we don't have the sealed keyword, now the compiler has no way to enforce that we can't have another implementation available at runtime. So now I have to insert this default branch, which it's not the end of the world, but this is just another example of additional compile time checks that the compiler can do for you. There are other cases where this is useful, such as if you're doing instance of checks. If you know that your class is never going to be a descendant of your abstract class, or interface due to how it is sealed, then you can also check that at compile time as well. Generally speaking, sealed classes and interfaces, I think, are an awesome addition to the language. And I think as more folks get to know how they can be used and what their benefits are, I think we'll see them more and more in code. Additionally, since they were added as an official feature in JDK 17, as more and more people move to the LTS JDK 17 or 21 when that comes out, I think we're going to start seeing it more in code. And that was an overview of sealed classes and interfaces. I hope you found that video informative. If you have questions or comments, please drop a comment below. I really enjoy reading your guys' comments. And with that, I think I'm going to close out today's video. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.